The mind is in charge of everything, right? And the course refers to medicine as magic. And it is, because we're using something physical to affect something that's physical, rather than using the mind, which is really the source of our disease, as well as the means of curing whatever it is that's going on with us. And I think that when none of us know what's going to come up. When I had cancer, and I remember when I got cancer, I thought, no. This is just not, you know, this doesn't compute. That was 12 years ago, so I did the standard brand things, partly because of the fear of my wife and the doctor. Well, that's true. You know, I did the chemotherapy, but also did a natural approach at the same time to keep myself in good shape, but also just really never believed that it was going to be a man. I just never thought it. It just never occurred to me that way. And obviously it didn't. So that's what you can just continue to believe that. Or to know, whatever it is. But Ramakrishna died of cancer. Ramana Maharshi died of cancer. Helen died of cancer. Or something, you know, these bodies have got, I read this morning, the oldest man in the world died today. This just sounds like a big end of a joke, doesn't it? Actually, it was here in the United States, 112, up in Buffalo, New York. The oldest woman is 116. But something's going to take, these bodies have got their own built-in implodes, and they're all, you know, one of the things I always admire, like, I've never known Norman Kennedy sick in the 40 years that I've known him. But just like everybody, there's not so much hair anymore, and little thin shoulders, and had to have cataracts fixed, and it's just a part of the process. So the question is, how gracefully do we go through this process of disengagement from this body? We want to keep this, if it's a learning device, it's a tool, we want to keep it as healthy as we possibly can and working as well, but that's part of the making the right choices with the same mind as well, so that we don't let the body try to rule or dominate. There's this, the ego body, of course, is the body's ego's chosen home. So on a ego level, we're very, very, very identified with these bodies, and on the ego level, we do think this is who we are, despite the fact that this is not who we are. And these experiences that we're talking about of Nita Bhajani and even Alexander just prove this is not who you are. It's not, except for a flash of a moment, and then that flash of a moment is gone, but a lot of things seem to happen in that flash of a moment. But still, it all depends on what's going on here, as to how we view what's happening with it. You can have a body that's limited to a wheelchair and be perfectly happy, because it's where the mind's at, it's not where the body's at. All right, so let's proceed. We're on page 4. I'm going to kind of go through the notes. I'm going to go down to the following 4. The acceptance of the atonement by everyone is only a matter of time. This may appear to contradict free will because of the inevitability of the final decision. But this is not so. You can temporize, and you are capable of enormous procrastination. But you cannot depart entirely from your Creator, who set limits on your ability to miscreate. This, by the way, was meant for Helen. You know, I know some of the stuff was meant for Helen in particular. Especially in these early chapters, this is a lot for Bill and Helen and their relationship with them. So when it says here, you can temporize and you're capable of enormous procrastination, you know, that was directed toward her. But at the same time, Helen was this woman who had the tenacity to put this all down and to stick with it. But, we all resist the healing process. We'd always, there's always some other way we'd like to go with it. And then going on down, beginning on the bottom of page four, tolerance for pain may be high, but it's not without limit. Eventually, everyone begins to recognize, however dimly, that there must be a better way. That is really reflective, of course, of Helen and Bill's initial experience, where Bill said to Helen that there has to be another way that they could get along with each other. It's inevitable. I think last time or the time before I talked about how if you look at some of the people we regard as being awake individuals, that they really came awake. People like Neil Walsh or Myron Katie or Bill Wilson, who founded Alcoholics Anonymous, or they all had these kind of incredible crash and burn experiences which facilitated the awakening process. But it doesn't have to be a crash and burn experience. Often at times it's just there's something inside you that begins to say that things are not as they seem and there must be something more. And so that there must be a real answer. It's one of the reasons why the churches are dying. Because a lot of people are saying there must be something more than dogmas and laws and creeds and regulations and rules. And the course is that something more. Because it's so incredibly deep. I think probably all of you who have spent time studying the course for a long period of time, you realize that it just keeps getting deeper and deeper and deeper. And it doesn't end, or it does end, but it doesn't end until you get enlightened. So, you know, we're going all the way home to heaven again. And when you get to heaven, well, then we can't even talk about it after that. Again, that's part of what, if you read, again, Anita Marjani, and ultimately you can't even talk about it. Ultimately, this transcends any kind of words. But words are what we've got in the meantime to work with, so we do the best we can with the words that we've got to learn what this is trying to say. But it's not just learning it, it's also what we're learning here, doing it. I mean, why don't you do what I'm asking you to do? And why don't we actually do this? We can do it. On the right-hand column, peace is stronger than war because it heals. War is division, not increase. I wrote that a week or two ago. I mean, at the time in which we were talking about going into Syria, and I was just thinking that the course is very, very clear that the ways of war are not the ways of peace. That we absolutely always, if you're going to be looking for the sanity in the situation, you attack is always, 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 always a mistake. The course is incredibly clear about that. And anger is never justified. The word is never justified, no matter how much it may seem to be. So that means that there's always another way. There must be a better way than hitting back. The task is to find the better way and to see what that doesn't mean that we don't confront error, but how do you do it without attacking? In one of Ken's books, he says, I've often said that one of the most difficult things that a Course in Miracles student can learn is how to be able to disagree with somebody else without it being an attack. And that really does require some talent, you know, to be able to disagree with somebody without it being an attack. It's really going to depend a lot on the other person, whether or not they're going to perceive it as an attack. You may not, if you're a boss or something, and dealing with an employee or a parent dealing with a child, it takes a lot of balance there to be able to get that right, to not be going, not hitting on the ego, so it's going to be perceived as an attack. So it just takes a lot of talent to get that right? Going on down, this ultimately reawakens spiritual vision, simultaneously weakening the investment in physical sight. So the course draws this in this article, in this issue of Miracles Magazine. The article is on part of these two different ways of seeing. Whether it's physical sight or it's spiritual sight. We're always moving toward the spiritual side. Corrective learning always begins with the awakening of spirit and the turning away from the belief of the physical sight, going on down. Spiritual vision literally cannot see error and merely looks for atonement. Literally cannot see error. Think about that. How could you literally not see the error? Sometimes as a parent, you can see it better with a child who misbehaves, and somehow or another you can look past it. You cannot see it because you love the child, right? So you don't see the problem, right? Or you can do it with any kind of loving situation. As a mate, you can see your mate being crazy, and it's okay. Let him be what he is. Seek not to make of love an enemy. And there's so much peace that comes from that. Right? And then down the bottom, spiritual sight reestablishes the power of the mind and makes it increasingly unable to tolerate delay, realizing it only adds unnecessary pain. As a result, the mind becomes increasingly sensitive to what it would once have regarded as very minor intrusions of discomfort. So that really means, as I said, you take this deeper and higher, that even little things that you would realize are a distraction for you are just places that you need to clean house. So we're always kind of cleaning house, even with some little distraction that may come up, some little judgment that may come up in your mind. You begin to notice all of it. So that you're completely cleaning out the psychic system so that it's all clean, it's all pure. The Course actually talks about what it calls perfect vision. So perfect vision is I don't see problems at all. But if I do see any kind of problems coming up in my mind, then I'm going to look, why do I see that? And then what can I do to correct that? Especially what can I do to correct it before I do some damage, like say something that might be hurtful to somebody else. There's a lot that we can let go of that doesn't need to be invested in. It's making the investment in it that exacerbates the error. On to page 5. The children of God are entitled to perfect comfort that comes from perfect trust. Until they achieve this, they waste themselves and their cruel and their true creative powers on useless attempts to make more comfortable by inappropriate means. The perfect trust is the perfect trust in God, and the perfect trust in the whole process, and the perfect trust in the system, the perfect trust in the atonement. It's going to undo everything. Inappropriate means would be anything that we use to run away from a problem, whether like alcohol, etc. The illustrations are obvious, the ways we don't look. Going on down. So the way out is often not doing anything at all. And I'll read that paragraph and we'll talk about that a bit. When peace comes at last to those who wrestle with temptation and the fighting against the giving into sin, when the light comes at last into the mind given to contemplation, or when the goal is finally achieved by anyone, it always comes with just one happy realization. I need to do nothing. Think how often that's true. It's not doing rather than doing that gets us into trouble, right? So doing gets us into trouble. So spending gets us into trouble, or overeating gets us into trouble, or drinking gets us into trouble. It's not doing, it's the not doing, just letting it be what it is, and letting the mind be at peace with what it is. It's the things that you don't say. Right? The projections that aren't thrown out upon the world that actually help us to come to find peace of mind. There's nothing we really need at all. All kind of eventually falls down into silence, right? Which is always the healing. All healing is essentially the release from fear. That makes sense. Only an ego can suffer. You're not, or only a body can, or an ego can suffer. And you're not a body and you're not an ego. Only the mind is capable of error. The body can act wrongly only when it responds to misthought. And now we're really getting into the part of this, this section about the power of the mind. Only the mind is capable of error. The body can act wrong only when it's responding to misthought. The body cannot create, and the belief that it can is a fundamental error, produces all physical symptoms. It's always the mind which is making choices and the decisions. It's never the body. We can blame it on the body, like I need something, like some sort of a need that we think is a bodily-based need, but it's never that. It's always coming from here. It's who's making the decision. Right? Did I use the illustration? I think I used it in here about my friend in Texas who... I'll do it. If I use some of his illustrations, Charles says he forgives me, so apparently I used one of them already. So I went to stay with a friend. Actually, I was going to be in Texas doing some lectures, and I had a buddy from college days, and his name will be not mentioned. And I called him up, and I says, I'm going to be in Dallas and Arlington and Fort Worth doing some talks, and I'd love to come see you. And he says, well, if that's fine, you can come see me, but I want to tell you that I'm a drunk. And I said, well, I'd like to see you. We've been pretty roommates in college, et cetera. And he says, okay, you can come see me, but you got to know I'm a drunk. I said, okay, I want to see you. So during a few days that I was there, I noticed that this is the way he began every day. He'd get up and go to the bathroom, just like we all do. Then go to the refrigerator, open refrigerator door, take out a can of beer, pop top one can of beer, take a swig of beer, set the can down, light a cigarette, sit down at the kitchen table, stare at the floor. That's the way that's the morning ritual, right? So I wrote a little piece about this that's called Who Pulls the Puppet Strings, which is really, who pops the top on the can of beer? Who's lighting the cigarette? And who's making the decisions? That's the point. And my friend, unfortunately, I think, thought that there was no choice. There was no, this was the way, this is the way it is. It's become a routine. It's become this kind of, well, think about what we do. Who's making the choices? Who puts that thing in your mouth? Whatever that thing is that goes into the mouth, or who pours the... Who pulls the puppet strings? Always think of who's moving. Who's making the decision? Who's the decision maker is really the question. And the thing is, we always know when we're in the wrong mind, and we always know when we're in the right mind. So why can't we just make this very simple switch? Actually, as you begin to make that switch, you do feel much happier. Because you know it's a choice with you're in line with the right mind. And it just feels so much, it's perfectly natural, it feels right. Just as like there's always something wrong with you because the other choice is always leading us into some sort of guilt. Well, the Course is saying, you know, your mind is very powerful. You realize how incredibly powerful it is, and you just make, it's a choice. Every single second, every single moment, every single day. Constantly, a choice. Eric?
I was just thinking, impossible to be in your right mind if you're not happy?
Yes. The question was, isn't it possible in your right mind if you're not happy? Yeah, of course. Just as if you are in your right mind, you're going to be making right choices. It's really that simple. It's so incredibly simple. But it keeps going back to this authority problem thing again. Because we keep thinking, well, I'll do what I want to do. You know, and I don't have to do it this tyrant's way. By the tyrant, I mean God. You know, God's a kind of the tyrant in terms of the ego. We're actually fighting against God. all the time, which means we're fighting against ourselves and defeating ourselves in the process. Right. Other questions? Right? I said we started with this quite building.
Yeah, you ever feel that everybody else's ego is attacking you? In other words, you're trying to live the course of hell, but you feel the outset, the pressure, you know, their way. Like you say, whose ego shall prevail? So, you know, like, sometimes you feel like you're being attacked yourself if you don't want to handle it.
Okay, so let me try to repeat what you said. See if I understand. So you're saying that sometimes you're feeling like other people...
Yeah, maybe make a little bit, like I'm a shop to make a decision. Everybody doesn't like it, it's not at all against you.
Right.
You still feel it's right. You don't feel like it's your ego rule. It's just something you feel.
You still have the strength. Right. It doesn't make any difference what anybody says.
But you do feel that fear, or you feel maybe because people work something that's going against you, their ego is attacking you.
But you're making the right decision despite the fact that,
yeah.
That you know. Well, that becomes the chore. The chore is that it doesn't make any difference what anybody else is saying. And it doesn't make any difference what anybody else is doing. That's where you got to rise above that so that you see that it doesn't make, that they're really coming out of ego. And you just leave it alone. That's a do-nothing thing again. You just leave it alone. Don't go there. Because why in the world would I want to feed something that's just this part of insanity again? Right? We can tell when an insanity is coming up. Well, there was this thing on television last night about how different kinds of games. They've got these police now that are deliberately wearing the other team's shirt and then going and sitting. You know what I'm talking about? Like at sporting events. There's a lot of fights happening at sporting events. And so they deliberately put on the other team and they go...
Trapping,
yeah. Right. It's you're like... get a fight started, and the police are there ready to arrest the minute, because apparently there's been too much of this. It's such an insane thing that you would attack somebody because they have on the other team's torture. I mean, it's just the level of insanities that we see in this world are very, very strange, aren't they? Yeah.
And last week, the ring was in the whole world. Fernandez. The guy that got locked up for New England. Everybody was wearing Fernandez shirts.
Amy?
Okay, John, I just want to come back to the gentleman who asked about right-mindedness.
Mm-hmm.
But just to, forgive me to say, just to flesh it out a little bit more.
Please, go ahead.
Wouldn't you say that right-mindedness is, you're not always feeling happy, but you're able to rise above the battleground enough to observe the personality? So you might observe that the personality is wretched, and mm-hmm. yet you're in that, you are in that place that is not attached
not
to the
engaged.
Personality. Not engaged.
Yeah. Yes, of course, you just don't engage. Mm-hmm. And it may be an incredible piece of insanity that's coming your way. And you just don't engage it at all. I mean, to engage it would be just silly. Right?
Yeah.
Yeah. Asking for trouble. Lynn?
Hi, I have a question about what you said before about never, ever, ever attack. It's something just came into my mind about World War II and the Holocaust.
If
we didn't attack.
Right. So the question is, do you ever stand up?
Yeah.
Yeah, obviously there has to be times when you do stand up.
Yeah.
We don't let murderers murder, we don't like rapists rape.
Yeah.
Yeah. The question is, how do you do that
without
the feeling of anger and attack, you know? And we can't let people misbehave in society. Right.
It's
right.
Kind of like a dance.
The question is, how do you do it without going this? Again, when I quoted Ken a while ago, one of the most difficult things for a Course in Miracles student to learn is how to be able to disagree without it being an attack. Mm-hmm. Right? So then, how do we resolve a situation? Obviously, we have to stop certain kinds of situations. Right? Like, we don't let murderers murder. Period. You know, that's just. And they go to jail because we don't know what else to do. We don't know how to correct the situation. You've heard me say, I used to work at Sing Sing. I always thought it strange when you pulled up the gate at Sing Sing, it says New York State Correctional Institution. And I thought, wouldn't that be nice? I mean, if it was a correctional institution, but it's not a correctional institution. But we don't know how to correct. All we know how to do is punish, or all we will not do is to stop it. You know, and that's all we really know.
And it takes a lot of enlightenment to love someone and not beyond the crime that they did.
Yes.
You had that experience.
Right. So keep in mind again, I said earlier that the Course is, remember in this passage, it's the sole responsibility of the miracle worker to accept the atonement for himself. So that's the big step, that's the main step, it's the sole responsibility to accept it for yourself. Now, if you do that, that's going to have a healing effect that's going to extend far beyond yourself, because it'll help to heal the environment that you're part of, whatever that's a family environment, a work environment, whatever situation you're in. But it's accepting it for yourself. Not, you can't force it onto somebody else. That's the whole part. Let's talk about healing again for a second. I had an email from a woman in California recently. She was talking about her psoriasis. This is really, really, really bad. And she was wanting me, I know, to kind of give her a formula for how you change your mind in such a way that she could get rid of her psoriasis. And I remember looking at saying, I can't do this. I mean, I can't give you a formula. I mean, it's not like there's an incantation or a chant or, you know, that's magic. You know, there's nothing like that we can do. It really is just all a matter of whatever that's going on in the mind. And you can't fix somebody else's mind. You can only kind of lead them in the right direction. You know, we can keep talking, and that's what we do in course study groups, etc. We keep talking about what is the right thing to do? What is the loving response? And how do I look inside this other's soul and see the face of Christ looking back at me? That's my job, to do that and to see only that. But the Course says you can't fix your... I can quote this exactly. This time I do know the right page. It's back actually in that same section, chapter 9, section 3. You cannot correct yourself. Is it possible then for you to correct another? Yet you can see him truly because it's possible to see yourself truly. It is not up to you to change your brother, but merely to accept him as he is. That's the main thing, is to accept him as he is, regardless of what's going on. Right? So that's doing nothing, and that's letting the situation be what it is. And one of the problems of the ego is we think we've got to fix things. And it's not your job to fix things. It's especially not your job to fix other people. There's only one thing that needs to be fixed, and that's we've got to fix the way we see things. And if we fix the way we see things, we change our own mind, that changes everything. Because you get to be at peace. What more do you want than that? You get to be at peace. And if you're at peace, it's a pretty good chance that the world around you is going to start becoming more peaceful, and I won't even know why. I mean, like, take a situation at work, for example, right? Let's say that you work with people, that's not always a peaceful situation in your work environment. But the very fact that you can walk into that environment and continue to be at peace regardless of the insanity that may be going on in the workplace, it does have this positive effect. And people do feel it. You know, and they will respond appropriately. Just because you're not responding inappropriately. How simple can it get? Right? Okay. All right, we'll go a little further with this. on the bottom of 5, on the left, and we do, our emphasis is now on healing. The miracle is the means, and the atonement is the principle, and healing is the result. Miracle means atonement, principle, healing, result. That's how it works. All healing is essentially released from fear, which we said earlier. And on the right-hand side. Did I read that only the mind is capable of error? Let's read that. Only the mind is capable of error. The body can act wrongly only when it's responding to misthought. The body cannot create, and the belief that it can is a fundamental error producing all physical sensitivities. Only the mind can create because spirit has already been created, and the body is a learning device for the mind. Actually, I'd like to... Alright, on the bottom is 6 on the left, just for the time of the moment. Notice, spirit is illuminated, the mind is capable of illumination, the body is too dense for illumination. I'll read that again, seeing how some of you are squibbling in place. Spirit is illuminated, always has been. And I think what happens with something like a Needham or Johnny is they get back into that illuminated state. When you read this experience that she has, you'll say that she slipped back into the illuminated state for a moment. She saw the whole, it was all clear. Once again, the mind is capable of illumination. So what we're doing in studying A Course in Miracles is we're really struggling to get back to that illumination again, to remember, to recall. It's a struggle, but it's perfectly possible for us to do this. And as you're progressing in the Course, it should work this way. I mean, you should feel progressively better. I had a friend who was in AA once tell me that a few weeks after he joined AA, he discovered that there was this new kind of clarity that came into his mind that he didn't know existed before. And I thought it was a good illustration that he didn't even realize. Yeah, because if you keep fogging the mind over, you keep burying the mind in this foggy place, how can you realize that there's actually a place of clarity? Well, leave the alcohol illustration behind and just take it into your normal consciousness. It's the same thing. You progressively move into the state of where there's more and more and more clarity, which makes it simpler and easier to make the right kind of choices. So that you get the right kind of results is because of the right kind of choices that you're making. So, and the last one, the body is too dense to be illuminated. In philosophy, there's always been this mind-body problem, and there is no mind-body problem in the Course, because the Course is very clear. You are mind, you are not a body. The body is totally neutral in terms of the Course. So it's totally up to how we choose to use the mind to deal with the body at all times. It's never the body that's... Even, I think my friend who pops the top on the top and thinks that he doesn't realize he's got any control over that. That there's no choice about doing those things. You know, what do we have to do to get to the point of realizing that there is a choice? Not just about something that's like a bodily-based behavior, but a behavioral-based behavior, too, in terms of the way we're relating to each other, the way we respond to each other. It's very simple, but we have this tremendous resistance to doing it, again, because of the authority problem. We want to do it our way, not God's way. It's just, that really is an ego issue. On the right upper side of 6. An imprisoned mind is not free because it's possessed or held back by itself. So think of my friend. An imprisoned mind is not free because it's possessed or held back by itself. It's actually as though he has a possession that's going on. It doesn't have to be that way. Let's look at the 7 principles of the miracles workers here. Also on page 6. So the miracle abolishes the need for lower order concerns. Principle number 2 from the Miracle of 50 Purposes says that thoughts can represent the lower or bodily level of experience or the higher or spiritual level of experience. So obviously we're progressively moving in a direction where we have the higher or spiritual level of experience. So we're letting go of all these bodily, it's not the body that's making, it never was the body that was making the decision, but we could think that it was. Two, a clear distinction between what is created and what is made is essential. And again, the Course shows the distinction between making and creating. As we already said, creating is whatever comes out of love. Making is whatever we make up in the world. We make up everything. I think of that in terms of, you want to make something out of it? It's like, yeah, you want to make something out of it? It's interesting, we use the words we use, make up. We make it all up. We literally make it all up. That's why, in the Course, it travels some, you'll see it gets made up lots of ways. Study history, you see it's made up lots of different ways. There's all kinds of ways we could make up what we make up. All of our religions are made up. Anything physical is something we make up, right? All of our ability, there's a line in the Course where it talks about the making beautiful buildings and sort of like churches and things. They're sort of misinterpretations of how to get back to God. Because we understand that you can build a building, a beautiful building, right? An impressive religious structure. It's just something that we make up. It's getting the mind back where the mind needs to be, not getting some sort of physical structure built. That's true with our bodies too, right? How are we going to make them up? Anything that's on the outside, it's not real. Anything on the outside is not real. Only the mind is real. Yes, Ruth?
So, I've been doing the work of miracles for a long time.
Yeah.
And at the same time, I dedicate myself to exercise and eating properly.
Sure.
And I find that a conflict in being a student of the Course and taking care of this body.
I don't think it should be a conflict.
Mm-hmm.
Because the body is an instrument, it's a tool, it's a learning device. So if I have a learning device or an instrument or a tool, I want to keep it in good working order. Right? So sometimes people will say, you can just sing how you know the body, you can just do whatever you want to with the body. Right? Which is, I knew a guy once, many years ago, who interpreted the Course in such a way, he says, you can just eat whatever you want to eat. Right. So he lived on a diet of hot dogs. So he loved hot dogs. He was addicted to hot dogs. He died. Choked to death on a hot dog. One of the things about reason, if this is about being reasonable, then we should make reasonable choices. Right? And we live in an age where we have a lot of information about what the right kind of choices are, as far as health is concerned. So, of course, you'll do the right thing, because the other alternative is that we kind of do sort of let the body rule by giving into the sweets or whatever it is. So, it's a simple choice. Don't feel guilty about doing a right thing. Other questions? All right, let's go on. We're up to three. Never confuse right and wrong-mindedness. Responding to any form of error with anything except the desire to heal is a mistake. The miracle is always a denial of error and an affirmation of truth. The level adjustment power of the mind induces the right perception for healing. Forgiveness is an empty gesture unless it entails correction. If it does not include correction, is essentially judgmental rather than healing. So one of the things that you can't do, for example, is you can't say, I forgive you. And if it's not real, if you're not really doing it, you just really let it go. Sometimes people will say, I can forgive, but I can't forgive. Well, if you can't forgive, you haven't forgiven. Because you've not really let it go. Yes.
Can you forgive and not trust? You know what I'm saying?
Yes, I do. I think what you mean is you can forgive and be cautious.
Yeah, that's what I'm trying to say.
Yeah, yes, of course. Of course, you can let the thing go, but at the same time, you raise your antenna level up a bit. So, of course, you don't want to be taken advantage of. Mm-hmm. Right. There was another one.
I just went to the sponsor at Marion Williams and said, just because I forgive them doesn't mean I have to have lunch with them.
Yeah, right. Yeah. Right. Anybody else? Okay. Let's go to page 7. Miracle minded forgiveness is only correction. It is no element of judgment. The statement, Father, forgive them, for they know not what they do, is in no way evaluated of what they do. And I think I've told the story of a woman taking adultery from the Bible before. I don't really remember. All right, I'll do this one. there's a story. I feel like I did this, but I might have done it in California. It's just not a story in the Bible where they bring this woman to Jesus who's been taken in adultery. And they say to him, according to the law of Moses, she should be stoned. What do you say? And you know this next, the great line of, let he who was without sin cast the first stone. And the next line is a very interesting line. The next line is, beginning with the eldest. So the oldest one there knows that they're not without sin, or they made some wrong choices. They begin to drop their stones and walk away. Eventually, there's nobody there. At which point, Jesus turns to the woman and he says to her, woman, where are your accusers? And she says, Lord, there are none. To which he responds, neither do I condemn you. Neither do I condemn you. Go and sin no more. In other words, go and don't keep making the same mistake. But the important thing is that neither do I condemn you. God does not condemn us. And that's a huge mistake that traditional Christianity made, in thinking that God somehow or another condemns us, and that we have to have retribution, or the concept of the atonement as it used to be, rather than as the course is talking about, that you have to atone for your sins or do something or suffer somehow or another. There's no suffering involved in the course at all. How could you do that? But you do want to correct whatever the error was. You know, fix it. You want to keep doing it. God does not forgive sin simply because God never condemns. You can't have forgiveness unless first you've got condemnation. But if there's no condemnation, why in the world would you have forgiveness? There's no forgiveness in heaven. What would you need it for? There's no judgment in heaven, so there's no forgiveness. Okay. Let's keep in mind, it's a tool that we need here that we can use. But once it's just a tool. You know, we don't need tools in heaven. Heaven is really understood as a place of perfection. It really is perfect. By definition, that's what it is. Because I think we think that it's just not possible. You know, but it is possible. That's what perfect happiness is. Perfect happiness is really the awareness, of course, is a perfect oneness, which is wholeness, which is again is how we can define heaven. Heaven is a place of perfect oneness, wholeness. Yes, Lily Katz.
Well, I have a question about, I understand what you're saying, but I always thought that the word forgiveness, well, just the word forgive, seemed like, what exactly does that mean? For,
you mean giving
for?
For
the purpose of giving, or, I mean,
yeah,
I was wondering if you know anything about how that came to be.
Right, no, I don't, but the word for is there before the giving, right? So we're giving before. So we're really letting us, we're really saying nothing happened. That's what happened. When forgiveness occurs, it was a true forgiveness. Nothing happened. We were in no way hurt or offended or disturbed. God doesn't forgive us because God's not upset with us, ever. And the same thing would be our response to others.
So what are we giving exactly?
You're giving, actually, you're giving nothing. By giving nothing, I mean, what you're doing is not condemning in the first place. So that's the four, is you're letting it go, but nothing literally happened. You cannot be hurt. Of course, says that several times. Your body can be hurt. And there's a line, of course, are thoughts dangerous to bodies? Yes. But otherwise, they're not dangerous. Sticks and stones may hurt my bone, may break my bone, but words can never hurt me. That old children's thing. Unless I think that they can. And if I think that they can, then I'm really into it. Michael?
What is the exact line? Is something like, forgiveness recognizes that what your brother has done has never occurred?
Right.
Something like that?
Exactly. Michael says, forgiveness is the recognition of what your brother did. It's never occurred. Of course it never occurred. How could it occur? You thought it occurred. You made it occur. Right? In your mind, it occurred. Norma?
Isn't it because you're not there? Nobody's here. We're not here. Correct?
Yeah, on some level,
you
can go there.
Metaphysically, you're not.
Yeah, metaphysically.
That's why,
right,
when you're forgiven because they didn't do anything.
Right. So again, because only an ego could perceive that, and you're not an ego. There is no such thing as an ego. That's a really important point. You have to understand that. Only an ego could get attached or think that it could be hurt or offended in some way. You are not an ego. So how in the world could you be hurt, attacked, offended in any way? Over here and then... Amy? In front of Amy first?
No, I didn't read
that. Okay, Amy.
Also, the process, the practical application of forgiveness is forgiving every interpretation, every perception, every belief, every opinion, every judgment to the Holy Spirit. And that is the undoing process.
Right. Right, you're just turning it over.
Just turning it over, right. So it gives you something to quote-unquote do while you feel like you really are a person.
Yeah. Diane.
Also, when when I'm forgiving, I think I also need to forgive myself because I'm the dreamer of the dream.
Oh yes, of course.
I'm the dreamer. I'm making all of this up.
Right.
So the words are so record. Easy to forgive because of that.
Sure. And you're always forgiving yourself.
Always.
Always. And you're always only forgiving yourself. You're always only forgiving yourself because you're the one who made the decision in the first place.
Exactly.
Right. You're the one who made the decision that there was a problem here.
Right.
So, now I said that if you really forgive, if you really do it, I mean, you really let something go, then there's this wonderful thing that happens in your mind, which is that you go, oh my God, I'm the one that's forgiven. Because I'm free, I'm liberated. This is no longer a problem for me in my mind. You know, it doesn't make any difference about the other ones. I mean, they may or may not have an issue about whatever the issue is. But only they can set themselves free. This is only we can set ourselves free. This is a very important point, and it comes up here somewhere in this material that we're going to get to right now or later. But Jesus in this chapter says, if I intervene between your thoughts and their results, I will be tampering with the basic law of the universe. The most basic law there is the law of cause and effect. So he said, I can't intervene. This is very, very important. I cannot intervene between your thoughts and their results. To do so is to tamper with the basic law of cause and effect. The most basic law there is. So it's always up to us about these choices. This is where free will comes in. The free will is we have the right, we're the ones who are making the choices. Only we can heal that. Because only we have made ourselves sick in this process. That the people say things, well, like, why doesn't God fix XY situation or heal this? But it can't because of the law of cause and effect. You know, the healing has to come from the mind that misperceived to correct it to not perceive correctly. And then the healing occurs. Nancy?
Everything that the Course tells us and everything you've been explaining to us, we are told is what we already know. We already know
yes,
everything that's in there.
Right.
And the reason that we have to have this explained to us over and over again and read it over and over again
right.
and keep forgetting intentionally all
right.
of these things,
yeah.
Bottom line is because we are terrified of God. Is
yes.
that correct?
Yes.
We are afraid we'll be punished or he will destroy
yes.
us if we remember everything.
We are stubborn as all get out.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, we just can't let go.
Or fearful as all get out.
Yeah, well, it's the same kind of thing, I think. But we just can't let God win. Because if we let God win, we lose. Now, we don't lose, but the ego loses. Or this thing which doesn't exist loses out, and thank God. Because that's the thing that created this world. That's the insanity.
Yeah.
This all just disappears in a moment.
But the only reason it's maintaining this world is that it is afraid it's going to be destroyed.
Right.
And underneath that is just a fear of God's love,
right.
of going back to heaven.
Yes, of course.
So that's the main correction that needs to be done in our mind is
that's
to
right.
lose the fear of God and coming home.
That's all it is. It's pretty simple, isn't it? And yet we're all here reading this book and struggling with this entire process, going through the exercises all to learn what you just said. And yet we have this tremendous resistance to it. It's just amazing that we have such tremendous resistance to doing something that is so ultimately incredibly simple. The whole course is very, very, very simple in that sense. Lady over here, and then Nora.
So it's like as long as we're here, we're guilty.
Right. Well, yes. It's kind of like that, you know. But it doesn't have to be that way in the sense that we are moving toward enlightenment. We are moving. We are learning how to get it right. So that we don't have to think we're going to have to continue to wallow around in this guilt forever, because. You don't. There is a door. And so we're really just kind of working on trying to open that door. Norma?
Okay, when we are enlightened and we're in the state of mind of heaven,
right.
but we, the ego, we disappear.
Right.
I'm not Norma and you're not John. And
right.
we just disappear. And I think that's also a problem because we don't want to disappear. We like ourselves.
Well, that's the fear that Nancy's talking about. The fear is that we will disappear. Right. And you will disappear, but see, the thing that the ego doesn't get because it can't get it is this is the most beautiful, blissful thing that there is. Again, read Anita Moore Johnny's description, but she disappeared, and even Alexander too. They both say they weren't there. And there was no Anita there. There was no Eben there. There was no person there. There's not going to be a Norma there or a John there. You know, but what happens, and this is when you read the mystics' descriptions of their experiences. You read these descriptions and then you find out that what is there is so far beyond any little thing here, going from a worm's eye view, you know, to... In my description, my experience in 76, I used the ant's eye view as what I came up with. They go from an ant walking across the floor here, stepping on my shoe, and looking at it, has no idea what this thing is. They couldn't possibly understand what this gigantic thing is, right? Well, it's kind of like that in the sense that there's this other... The state that becomes available, the Course calls it simply oneness, the state of oneness. Now, we have tremendous resistance toward the oneness because the ego wants to be one all by itself. But that one is very lonely. That's why what's called for is, of course, this divine abstraction, which is a name for God, takes joy in sharing. It's the sharing that becomes exciting. And in the sharing, there's also there's no loneliness. That's why we love falling in love, because when we fall in love, we're sharing our minds with us, and we just want to give to the whole. What the creative process is, a process of giving love, just giving love. It's all just continuously. I mean, it's beyond our. Everybody will say it's beyond description. Right? And also, if you just think for a moment about, and I mentioned this in these notes here, the people that we would regard historically as the ones who are really the most outstanding individuals in the course of history are really the great humanitarians. I mean, the people who have really done the most for the whole is the Mother Teresa's and the Martin Luther King Jr.'s and the Albert Schweitzer's. And, you know, it's the ones who sort of went out of themselves to make that bigger contribution without paying, without going after the money or whatever it was. That's what the ego chooses to do, to build its towers, you know, here in New York City, or wherever the towers. I'm not talking about that. Yes.
The prayer, "Thy will be done." I guess that could be said with a full heart.
Yes, exactly. Yeah.
Could
you
repeat that?
Yes, of course. She says, "The prayer, thy will be done." It's interesting that that's the first line of the Lord's Prayer. Mm-hmm. And the very first line is very simply, "Thy will be done, thy kingdom come." And that's the first step. That's all that we really want, is to allow God's will to rule. Again, of course, as one of our basic problems is the authority problem. So we say to God, "Thank you very much, God, but I'd really rather do it myself." And God says, "Fine. Go ahead. And do it all you want to. We can't stop you because you have free will. But you'll just keep doing it until you muck it up so badly that it'll all fail, and then when it fails, you'll come back home again." Which is inevitable. But the Course says, "Why not come home now? You know, why wait for heaven?" That's a line from the Course. Why wait for heaven? Heaven is here. There's no place. Heaven is now. There's no other time. Larry, did you want
to... Well, I just wanted to say one thing that helps quell the fear a little bit is to realize that ego dissolving or expansion is not amnesia. These people did write books about that experience. They didn't forget who they were. They come back and they were able to integrate it. The mind in that body still has the memories.
Yes.
And I think part of the fear of the ego is that it's going to lose its memory of what it is or who it was. So at least while you're in this lifetime, you can take a little comfort in the fact that people have been there, didn't forget everything,
right,
and they come back to prove it by writing about it.
Right. It's interesting because in both of these two cases, as well as in other cases, the question is, who does remember it? Because it's not like there's no body there at the time. And they both will say that. They don't, the personalities, but there's something remembers it. That's why in the Course, toward the end, in chapter 28, I think it is, there's a section called Present Memory. And it's about the memory. It's not a past memory, because it couldn't be a past memory. It's a present memory. It couldn't be a future memory. Present memory is coming home to God again. It's remembering the truth of who you always have been. And you've never lost that. You can't lose that. That's why the experience is really one of an awakening. That's why, again, what we're experiencing here is that we're really, it's in a place, remember a passage I read a moment ago, only after Adam fell asleep could he experience nightmares? Well, we fall into this place where we're unconscious and we experience nightmares in this place, right? But once I awaken to the truth of my identity as a child of God, there are certainly no nightmares there. you know, there's this other experience which just becomes so blissful that the folks who write about it say that they can't even write about it because it transcends language.
John? I just wanted to say one thing about when you were talking about the idea of forgiveness, forgiving and forgetting, and what is forgiveness. It just occurs to me that when somebody has quote unquote offended me, and I try to practice, in my mind, oh, I forgive that person. I forgive you. I'm actually needing to offer the forgiveness to God or my higher God mind or whatever I'm choosing, rather than to that person in my mind, that I need to offer that forgiveness when I say I'm going to forgive that person. I actually need to be saying that to whatever I call God, you know, higher spirit or whatever, that I forgive that thought. I forgive, I give this. This is forgiving to you at the altar there. One of my defects here. I'm forgiving. This act is now forgiving this to you so that I'm not moving forward with it.
So you're not carrying it around anymore.
Because that takes the other person's, whatever they've done,
out of it. Yeah, completely.
Which is where it needs
to be. That's part of what we were saying earlier. It has nothing to do with the other. It never has anything to do with the other.
Yeah.
There is no other.
And by me saying, oh, I forgive that person, actually keeps it right there.
Right. Of course, because you're making it there. You're putting it there. See, one of the most important concepts in mysticism is the realization there is no subject-object. So when I say there is no subject-object, it just means that there is no other. There's no difference. If there's no subject-object, then there's nothing to be projecting onto, because there's nothing there. All there is that's there is whatever I'm seeing. And if I'm seeing love, if that's all that I'm experiencing that's going on, then that's all that there is there. Separation is the idea that there's something there that shouldn't be there. That there's something wrong. Right? It's the thought that something's gone wrong. That's where the whole break, the whole separation process occurred initially. And that thought was, by the way, the thought, and I've said it before, but this will just reiterate, that you can think a thought outside of the mind of God. You cannot actually think a thought outside of the mind of God. That is impossible. But trying to think a thought outside of the mind of God is the thing which gave, as I said before, rise to this whole world. And we continue to try to do that. We continue to try to build our own world, to make our own way. And you can't do it. That's why Christ-mindedness, realization, means that we give the mind totally back to God again, not partially. It's got to be all the way. You got to go all the way home. And there's no reason you can't do it, except for, as I said a while ago, stubbornness, or a better word is arrogance. You know, or I like to play it for myself. Yeah, but that just creates misery for me. Yes, Diane.
Why does Jesus what?
Ask us to forgive him.
Oh, that's always a good question.
Maybe you want to answer that?
No. Yes. You would. Well, it's for what he didn't do. It's for being better than him, completing the process. I've never really understood that very well. You want to say something now, Ian?
I'll take a chance.
Take it.
I want to say that I was raised with no religion, so oddly enough, I'm involved in the course, and I have no Bible references, and I'm just a complete ignoramus when it comes to Jesus. But I think that works in my favor sometimes.
Mm-hmm.
Well, in the world, Jesus was crucified on the cross by us. And he represents, it's hard to put into words, but Jesus represents everything the ego is against. He's the symbol of love. And as you were saying before, beyond the fear that God will punish us is the fear that we will evaporate back into God's love. So if we allow ourselves to forgive Jesus, we think we love Jesus, but we don't. We hate Jesus. Because the ego has reversed everything. What the ego calls love is hate. So all of this love of God and Jesus, the Course is revealing to us, is actually the opposite. We're carrying this deep, unconscious guilt for having murdered God. The ego, when it thinks it's separated from God, believes that it has murdered God. And being an irrational, chaotic mind, it also thinks that God could rise from the grave and get vengeance and murder it back. So in this crazy mishmash, could you take it from here?
You did a very good job. That was a very good Ken would explain it.
Yeah, I'm a Ken devotee.
Charles?
I just want, when I forgive another person, course-wise, I had something against this person. I established a separation between that person and myself in my mind, and then I have to let that evaporate through asking the Holy Spirit or whatever. Jesus, it seems to me, historically, has been presented to us, even theologically, as so other, so different from ourselves, that that is one of the things I think he's asking us to forgive,
right.
to let that go and take him at his word that he's just an older brother. Mm-hmm. And he says someplace in the Course that the world has made so many vicious idols out of him, and he wants to be forgiven for that. It's just he wants to stop the misunderstanding that he and I are, there's a oneness there.
That's what I was meaning to say, that I'm not right there.
Yeah, I was just going to refer to that line, forgive me for all that was done in my name.
Right. Yeah, historically, there's been a tremendous amount of mess that's been made out of traditional Christianity. It's completely missed the message here. Put everything on the body, for example. So we wind up worshiping the body of Jesus, putting it on a cross and hanging in their churches. You know, not doing what he asked us to do, but, you know, he suffers by us and bleeds for our sins. My goodness. You know, how that talking about guilt, you know, that really lays it on you in a really, really heavy way. There's been a lot of corrections needed there. Yes? I'm sorry, say again.
If good comes out of evil things, like you were mentioning, maybe everything's okay. Like we're not really saying anything wrong. We're not really doing anything wrong.
Well, yes, that's true. That's why, again, even Alexander keeps using this phrase, which I'm sure people have trouble with, you can't do anything wrong. Mm-hmm. Which is hard to understand how that's true. But all mistakes are really just a part of the process of the learning that we go through. So that we get back to home again, and the clarity that way as well. You can't help but make the right choice even when it's the wrong one, which sounds very, very strange, but it's absolutely true. Right. That was something that came to me in that experience I had in 76 as well. It was amazing. Every time I would make the wrong choice, it would turn over and come out right. Think about how that may have happened in your life as well. So, Sam?
My ego is exhausted from remembering and being in competition with God. I'd like to remind you about the meditation idea.
Yeah,
Just, please.
Okay, so.
Thank you.
We're 4 minutes away from it. I said we had a quarter hour.
I just want to say that line, all things are lessons God would have me learn.
Right, all things are lessons, exactly, it's perfect. So regardless of whatever it is that's going on, but I want to be paying attention to what's going on. That's a lot of what the Course is saying, you know, pay attention to what's going on. Don't keep going unconscious, pay attention to what's going on so that you can change it and fix it. So let's do the rest of the, you know, one of the reasons for me creating these outlines is that I feel like I may not get through all of it, and I don't, so you can, if you want to, read the rest of it. We're up to near the end of it, anyhow, Fear and Conflict. Okay. Actually, leave that page 7 on top of your, because I'd like to read a section from there at the end together. So let's do a meditation as to calm Sam's mind. And what I'd like to do is I'm going to share with you a slight revision of one of the workbook lessons from A Course in Miracles. Actually, can we turn the lights down? Are we going to do that right there? The dog turned up so completely that I can't see it. Right, what about there? No? All right. Well, we'll find it in the future, another time. But I do suggest you close your eyes and be quiet. Take a couple of deep breaths and relax. And be very present. Because there's no place else to be right now. So I'll read this, and at the end of it, we're going to just have about 5 minutes of silence. This is lesson 49 from A Course in Miracles. God's voice speaks to me all through the day. It's quite possible to listen to God's voice all through the day without interrupting your regular activity in any way. The part of your mind in which truth abides is in constant communication with God, whether you are aware of it or not. It is the other part of your mind that functions in the world and obeys the world's laws. This part is constantly distracted, disorganized, highly uncertain. God's voice speaks to me all through the day. The part that's listening to the voice for God is calm, always at rest, wholly certain. It's really the only part there is. The other part is a wild illusion, frantic and distraught, but without reality of any kind. Try today not to listen to it. Try to identify with the part of your mind where stillness and peace reign forever. Try to hear God's voice call to you lovingly, reminding you that your Creator has not forgotten you. God's voice speaks to me all through the day. We are actually trying to hear God's voice, reminding you of Him and of yourself. We approach this happiest and holiest of thoughts with confidence, knowing that in doing so we are joining our will with the will of God. He wants you to hear His voice. He gave it to you to be heard. God's voice speaks to me all through the day. Listen in deep silence. Be very still. Open your mind. Go past all the ruckus, weeks, and sick imaginings that cover your real thoughts and obscure your eternal link with God. Sink deep into the peace that waits for you, beyond the frantic, riotous thoughts and sights and sounds of this insane world. You do not live here. We are trying to reach your real home. We're trying to reach the place where you are truly welcome. We are trying to reach God. God's voice speaks to me all through the day.